Come on in. Is this on? But the people, is that better? Okay, I have to practically eat it. But there it is. So come on in, have a seat. I'd like you to take a few seconds to greet your people sitting around you, and maybe one more person that you don't normally say hello to. Good, this is great. So there'll be time for socializing afterwards, that's for sure. Thank you, Bodhi. Now's the time to turn off your electronic devices. See if mine's off. No, yep, yes. It is, good. Yes, mine's off now too. So, now's the time I get to say 30 seconds, and it's going to be hard to do it, but I'm going to do it fast. First of all, I want to have a great thanks. We're in the middle of a transition, and Reverend Karyl is, this is her last month.
No.
And Reverend Mary Shelton, this is close to your first day. And I just wanted to welcome, since I'm the welcome man, the once and present queen. And there, it's actually a throne there. And the future queen is over here. Mary Shelton. Thank you. Now, I want to also thank some special people. In fact, everybody will be included in this. First of all, and you don't need to stand or raise your hand, there'll be a chance for that later. Anyone who is here for the first time, now, don't have to identify yourself, but I do want to welcome you. It's got to be a little confusing to be coming to a church the first time and then full of a heartfelt, important transition. The second group, and I wonder if you might raise your hand, are the people who were here for Reverend Karyl's first year, or first one. Wow. Oh. I had no idea. Now, the third group is the people, this isn't their first day, but you're still deciding whether this will be your home, your family. You don't have to raise your hand, but we're aware of you. And maybe you've been coming here for a few times, maybe for as much as a year or two. It takes a while. I certainly remember that. And then the last group is everybody else. Between everybody else. So everybody has been welcomed. So thank you very much. Is that 30 seconds? I think that did it. Okay. So now we'll have music, we'll have a chant, and then wise words from Marilyn, who is our practitioner of the day.
I belong to the morning. I belong to the dawn. I belong to the morning. I belong to the dawn. My way was dark, and the road was long. The way you come, like the path. Yeah.
For our chant this morning, we have a prayer chant that was written, the words by Janet Carol Ryan. And we have Janet's drum with us this morning. So this prayer song is going to be for Janet. I am love revealed. I am love revealed. All that was separate is now healed. I am love revealed. I am love revealed. All that was separate is now healed. And being love, thou art a pure expression of my divine heart. I am love revealed. I am love revealed. All that was separate is now healed. I am love revealed. I am love revealed. All that was separate is now healed. And being love, thou art the pure expression of my divine heart. I am love revealed. I am love revealed. All that was separate is now healed. I am love revealed. I am love revealed. All that was separate is now healed.
And so I open, and I invite you to open with me to that unshakable, precious, tender awareness of the infinite life, of the one perfect life, the one life of all creation, the one life of our dear one who wrote those words, I am love revealed. And truly, truly, that has to be the truth for each one. For each one is a reflection of that changeless love, that changeless center of all creation, the source of all, the supply of all needs, the answers to all prayers, that one great life, that source of infinite possibility, that life whose command is to always expand. The imperative of all creation is more love, more peace, more beauty, and growth and expansion. And as I am part of this life, I know that I can go there when I'm withered by change, when I might feel frightened or resistant. I go to that center where the source reassures me that there is unthought of good waiting to express itself through and as me and through and as each individual person. That whatever each one thinks he or she is, they are always more. And there is more of life around what looks like the end in a road, perhaps, is just a bend. And there is more and more and more to be revealed. And so I give thanks that in the midst of change, the changeless one reveals itself in every life. And I give thanks for that receptivity for every person here today, that there is a special gift, something waiting for them if they are awake during this time together. There is so much to be shared and to be revealed. So for this perfect receptivity to the words of our beloved Reverend Karyl, the music and the eyes of God in and as each one here, I give my thanks. And so it is. Amen.
I am love revealed. I am love revealed. All that was set.
Call me your majesty. I would like to, if anybody has an empty seat beside them, could you raise your hands, and maybe the people who are acting as ushers could kind of see where the hands are. It's so sweet of all of you to be here today. So I just want to draw your attention to these amazing decorations, and including the throne upon which I sit, which was a part of the most amazing party last night. And there was just so much work that was done, and I feel so loved and so appreciated. And Sue Ruda, who was the queen mama, of course, of it all last night, is going...
Deborah.
She's going to acknowledge all the team members when she comes up at
Deborah,
the...
Deborah Welsh.
And Deborah Welsh.
Deborah
and
Stewart.
Deborah had to work this morning, but she texted me and said what a great time it was last night, and it was a great time. So there's many remnants of it around. I want you to just enjoy this after the service. And from my storehouse of my robes and my jewels, I have brought an array for my subjects. And so you are all welcome to all of that over there. And I'm very happy to give it.
I like that, a queen that gives away everything instead of taking everything.
Yeah, yeah. That's really what the royalty should do, you know. That is the trickle down, but we won't go into that. But this morning, miracle of miracles, not only am I your queen, but I am your troubadour. And so we're going to, I'm not going to put that on anymore because it's, it just makes me think about being the queen, and I need to think about being the musician, and your wonderful spiritual leader for two more Sundays. So for the first solo slot, I'm going to be playing four chants that we all know so well, but it's what. It's what I want to leave with you as my message. And so I'm really going to try not to cry, because I certainly cannot sing and cry at the same time. You know, I'm putting off the music. I'm doing this workshop this afternoon on how to download a talk from Spirit. And one of the skills that I believe I have mastered, and you will master too, in being a wonderful spiritual speaker, is how to talk and cry at the same time. But I cannot sing and cry. So anyway, that's so please join in when you get what we're singing here.
Thank you.
May you be filled with loving kindness. May you be well. May you be peaceful and at ease. And may you be happy. May you be filled with loving kindness. May you be well. May you be peaceful.
Thank you.
I tell Bodhi, he's like Fred Astaire. He makes me look so good. I have to look around the throne. Good. For those of you who are here for the very first time, this is a unique Sunday. But we would warmly, warmly like to welcome you. We have some people here from our membership team, and they have packets of information for you. And if you would fill out the little blue card in there and take it back to that table by the stairs and give us the card, you'll get one of these little books that's called What Religious Science Teaches. So anyone here for the first time who would like one of these little books and like a packet, there's one back there, way over there. And everybody else is old family, huh? Well, it's very nice to have you here. So let me just get going on. Yeah, okay, good. I wonder how many times I'll do that this morning. But our theme for this whole year is 100 years of science of mind. So, you know, over the years, what I have done is more for myself than for you, but I think it's been helpful. I have kind of shrunk our teaching down to two main ideas, which are oneness and mastery. And the one feeds the other. Oneness is all life is one and all life is divine, and the life in you is God's life, the goddess's life. It's the same life that's in the tree and the bunnies and the deer in the fields and all of that. It is sacred and it is everlasting. It is the life that was expressed through Janet Carol Ryan and is still expressing now that she is in the next realm, to which we are all headed, of course. And then when we live from that oneness, because God is all there is, and within God are all possibilities and all answers and all solutions, then we are masterful. And mastery is simply that you live the life that you want or you love the life that you have, and that's it. So last night, this party was such an example of both oneness and mastery, because I never felt closer to everybody in my whole life than we did last night. And it was so adorable because they had Paul, my consort, up here, and it was really a kind of a power thrill, actually. And I got to knight him with a sword. And but the masterfulness, I mean, there were a few people with those little headsets on that fit better than my headset fits me. But they were talking to each other about what comes next, and it was seamless. It was absolutely perfect. It was amazing. So oneness and mastery is what we have here in the community, in the teaching, and it's what we have out there as well when we live our life well. So the theme for July is revealing wholeness. And that fits right in, because when we live from oneness, we express mastery, and then we express the wholeness that we are, because wholeness means that we're not lacking anything. And because our divine life is God's life, we can't be lacking anything. So the title of my talk today, which, by the way, this is actually the last talk. Next week will be ceremony. And although I'll speak, this is the last talk. And so what can I say? You know, what that I mean, I've said it all. And so telescoping once again down to the essential. All is love. Love is all. I want to, and so love is everywhere in this place, expressed in so many ways. But right now, this is a Frost family altar that is so precious. It has the yellow submarine there. It has the rainbow. It has all kinds of symbols of love. It has the Buddha and precious symbols of the Frost family, including a picture of their wedding. So I want to thank the Frosts for that. On NPR this week, I was listening to a story about originally it was a 9-year-old girl who kept asking questions of her father. And her father, who was a professor, really wanted to answer her, but she would just, you know, have a question when he was trying to prepare. So he said, okay, look, you write down all the questions that you have, and I will answer them all. So she wrote down pages of questions like, how does time work? How do we know when something is beautiful? Are the things we say are good always good? Pages of this stuff, and handed it to her professor dad. So her father, wanting to encourage deep thought and interested himself, started doing research. And the girl at the time of this interview was now 13. And honestly, what she wanted was just more of her dad. She could care less about these questions, you know. But what happened was they did start talking more and talking deeply. And what was the most amazing thing is that he said after 4 years of research, he'd answered most of them, but the one that he could not get a handle on at all is what is love. And what happened, of course, is that they were doing it. They were doing it by him answering the questions and by her getting more time with her dad. So what I got was that we it's really like one of those things where we know it when we have it. And I just want you to know that we have it. We have it here. People who come to this community say the same thing. They say, oh, it's so loving. Everybody feels so, I felt included. And so that is all of our work, all of our week, and we've done very well. And I've been telling River Mary what a soft, glorious, loving nest she is going to lay her eggs in. So, another example of love is this next, is this Janet up here now? Okay. So I'll just ask you if I'm on track. Remember what we did last Sunday? We sent love to Janet and we sang that song to her that was about her coming home. And it was Monday at 12:15, just in the early afternoon, that she breathed her last peaceful breath to the song that we sang, I Am Love Revealed. It was playing as she was making her transition. And so I want to express how much love there was for Janet during that transition time and how much love she pumped out into her little space. It was like walking into a temple when you came to her. Not ironically, but sweetly, Karen Drucker was there a great deal of the time when she was, doing the work of dying and responding to so many requests of Janet, you know, make sure so-and-so gets this and so-and-so gets this. And so it was arranged that the people who were her closest caretakers, those of us who were there with her for the last weeks, that we were meeting with her decorated, beautiful body temple at 1 o'clock on Tuesday afternoon. And Karen frantically sent us out an email on Tuesday morning, said, Janet told us all to wear white. So it was like one more request. And of course, we were all there wearing white. So What an amazing punctuation for these 23 years that we've had together, because Janet was in that first year as well, which is in this photograph. So I'm going to stand up and show you some people. There's our Janet, and there's our Frank, and there's our Sandy Walker, there's our Dana, and there's our Posey. That is love revealed. That is the foundation and the history of this community. And so another photograph of love is even older than that. This was from 1995, and this one is from 1989. And this was my first installation in the first church that I had, which was the Spiritual Arts Center, which Brent took over. And so we're all in this together. So this is my installation, and this is Reverend Mary, right there, yeah. Here's me, right there, looking a little astonished. Here's Reverend Lloyd, right here. And you know this one. This is Marcia Sutton, who was the minister before I came here. So this is your family tree. And then before you go, I want you to look at this photo up here. This was two different photos, the installation of me here in 1995, and before that is the church that we evolved from, which was the Spiritual Arts Center, the Community One Church of Religious Science of San Francisco. That was one of the names. And so you'll recognize several people in that photograph as well. So I just wanted to include these photographs for you because it's evidence of the love that is in this community. So back to telling you a little bit something related to Janet's transition. The people that you know that were with her very, very much at the end were Deborah Irwin, Karen Drucker, Francine Huss, and myself, and other good friends of hers. So someone that you might remember from this community is Samantha White. Samantha White will be here for Janet's celebration of life. And Samantha is, they were best friends. So after we did this ceremony with Janet's body, we were all sitting around in our white in her little apartment. And Samantha just spontaneously, this was on Tuesday, so this was the Tuesday heading up to this Sunday, and so we were all just kind of sharing about our lives, and I said, you know, I'm nervous about this Sunday because I have to say every single thing, and so Samantha, this is what she did, just like she had it planned, she said, "Well, Reverend Karyl, there are four things that I remember that you said." And then she started rattling them off. "These are my four favorite things that you said." So she said, the first thing is, you said, "Reality is wiggly." And I go, "That's remarkable." That's remarkable. Now, what that means, of course, is that something that you are damn sure is right is absolutely wrong. So what came to mind was, you know my story, stories of my life, you know that my birth father, I never really knew because my mom divorced him and moved across the country and I never saw him. So a long time after that move, I was 50 years old, I went and found my father's family in Michigan. So he was not a person that was spoken highly of in the family out here in the West, as you can imagine. You know, they divorced. But when I went back there, they said, oh, he loved you so much. He had already gone. They said he carried a photo of you in his wallet his whole life. Well, my reality instantly changed. Instantly changed. How many of you have had a wiggly reality? Yep. So Samantha goes, and next is you said, you just pointed your finger out at us and you said, you're as dead now as you'll ever be. And I said, well, that's pretty amazing as well. And it's true. You know, as unexpressed as you feel or expressed, but if you feel unexpressed, that's your deadness, but you're not going to get any deader than that. You're not. Because you and me, we are immortal. We go on forever. So don't worry about it. It can only go up from here. And next she said, and then there's this catch-all, it's a mystery. And, you know, I've said that a lot. And it is, it's a really good catch-all. You know, when you do not know the answer to something or you don't know the reason why something happened, it's a lovely thing to say it's a mystery, because you know that nothing can really go wrong in a divine universe. Nothing can really go wrong. And so to be able to label it, well, it's just, it's a mystery. I think that's so loving. I have held that in my own life. I've said it to you. I've said it to me a lot. And then the last thing she said, and the penguin story. Janet and I would just talk about what we want to do and what we didn't think we could do. But then we would just look at each other and say, we can do it because we're penguins. So is there anyone here that has not heard the penguin story? Oh, Suzanne Karch, you have, okay. All right, I have to stand up for this. So it's a very, this is like my signature piece, right? Okay. So the way we're going to look at this is a story about stepping into your next phase of life and me stepping into my next phase of life. So it goes like this. The story of the penguins is that in Antarctica, where the penguins live, they are hatched on land, and they don't know how to swim when they're babies. But if any of you that have seen National Geographic penguin movies, you have seen those little torpedoes underwater just going zip, 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 and then leaping and zip, zip, zip under the water. But the babies don't know how to do that. So when it comes time, the parents bring the babies to the edge of the cliff, and the parents jump in. And they peep, 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 peep up to their babies saying, come on, come on, come on. So some babies are so excited about this opportunity, and they fly off the cliff, plunge into the water, and swim, because that's their natural way. But most of the babies look at this foreign thing down there, the water, which is the next phase of all of our life. This is an analogy. And the babies go, then, you know, back and forth. And the parents go, come on. And they're going, and they plop in, probably because they tripped, right? And then they swim. That's fine. They're great. But there are some babies that are too scared. And maybe some of you, I know I have been in that place, where I'm too scared to move. And what happens is the tide comes in and sweeps all of the babies off the cliff, and everybody goes swimming, and they're all perfect swimmers instantly. They go into that next phase of life because it is the natural movement of their soul. That is the loving universe in which we live. That is the supportive nature of life, that we are supported in doing the next thing that we are to do. And so I feel like you are a part of my penguin family. And even though, you know, maybe some of you would rather I didn't go, you're all encouraging me, and I am leaping into this new phase of my life. And I owe it to your support and the support of my precious husband and the support of my own soul that will not be denied. So I got an email this week from, there's a new business manager at home office. And he said in this email that he wanted to meet via Zoom with all of the senior ministers, because he wants to know how home office can better help the senior ministers. So I got this email. So I first forwarded it to Reverend Mary, and then I responded back to him saying, I have forwarded it to Reverend Mary Murray Shelton. She will be undoubtedly contacting you because I am leaving my senior minister position in 2 Sundays. So he emailed me back, like with sympathy. And he said, oh, leaving a pulpit can be very difficult, and I wish you all the best. Well, you know, I took that as love. I didn't even respond. But what I want to tell you is that I am amazingly fulfilled, absolutely happy. I am happily anticipating my next phase in life, and I am stepping into a dream that I didn't even know I had of marriage, happy marriage, happy. Who knew? Yeah. and the dream of living in what feels like my homeland, you know. So a lot of people have asked how I did it because, you want to be as happy as me, and I want you to be as happy as me. And so I tried to think of what I did. And so I'll tell you that what was under my power, let me see if I got this on the right thing. Oh, no. One moment. That's what you should have been looking at. Okay, the love. So what was under my power, I kept doing. I kept praying. I kept taking people on trips. I kept going over there myself. And what was not under my power, I literally gave to the goddess. I mean, I was pretty ridiculous as I was on these dating sites for I don't know how long. And I mean, one no after another, after another, after another, either my no or their no. And I just said, okay, goddess, you take it. You find him for me. You find him for me. You find him for me. And so it was a combination of actually doing what I knew to do and surrendering what I didn't know how to do. That's it. Doing what you know to do and surrendering what you don't know how to do. That is my last lesson to you, except this one thing. So I tried to do three things all the time in my life, and that's this next thing. And it's what I'm leaving you with about loving one another, because that's what is really, really important in the spiritual community, is deeply, deeply loving one another. So is that what it says up there? Okay, good. The first thing is pour greatness into one another. Pour greatness into one another. You know, I look out at you, and I know so many life stories that of people that I'm looking at. I know so much courage. I know so much that you've overcome. I know so much growth that has happened in you. And that's true for everybody. Everybody really tries hard in life. If they're successful in their trials, then it makes everything happier. But boy, everybody's working hard, including the Safeway checkout person. And so the more that you can mirror back to everybody, I know your magnificence, I know how hard you work, and I can hold your joy along with you for you. That's pouring greatness into one another. And if we do that, instead of sit back and niggle at people, that's a better way of loving each other, and that's what I've tried to do. And next is live in your heart. Your heart will tell you things. And, you know, the definition of confusion is to have your head and your heart say different things. So your heart is not only where love resides, but it's also where fear resides. And so the tricky thing about living in your heart and following your heart is to follow the greatest demand of your heart and not the impulse of your heart. And if you don't know the difference, keep coming and get a practitioner. So the idea is to respond to your highest message of your heart, which is always about divine qualities. Love, light, peace, power, joy, harmony, creativity, generosity, abundance, those kinds of things. That's the response of your heart that I want you to make, not, I've got to have this. Whatever it is, that's the impulse. And then the final thing is my ongoing lesson, tell the truth with gentleness. We all have what we know to be the truth, and that's one of those wiggly realities. You know, what's true now may not be true tomorrow, but we feel compelled to speak our truth when whatever version of it it is that we have inside our heart. And if we do that with gentleness, we will have a gentle world. So that's it. That's what I want to leave you with. These, the five things. Do what you know how to do, what's under your control. Surrender what is not under your control. Pour greatness into each other. Live in your heart and tell the truth with gentleness. That's it. So I have piles in my house. Store, ship, give away, like that over there, and keep with me every moment. This is a book that I'm going to keep with me every moment. It's Anamkara by John O'Donohue. And in conclusion, I would like to read to you a little bit. It's about us. When you find the person or people you love, an act of ancient recognition brings you together. It is as if millions of years before the silence of nature broke, your clay lay side by side. Then, in the turning of the seasons, your one clay divided and separated. You began to rise as distinct clay forms, each housing a different individuality and destiny. Without even knowing it, your secret memory mourned your loss of each other. While your clay selves wandered for thousands of years through the universe, your longing for each other never faded. This metaphor helps to explain how, in the moment of friendship, two souls suddenly recognize each other. It could be a meeting on the street or at a party or a lecture or a spiritual center. There is a flash of recognition and the embers of kinship glow. There is an awakening between you, a sense of ancient knowing. Love opens the door of ancient recognition and you enter. You come home to each other at last. And that's what I feel we have. We have our clay that laid together for billions of years, that made itself into these beautiful bodies that we walk around in. And we here have reunited our clay together. That's why we're so happy to see each other again. Thank you. So this next song is, I think of it as what I'm going to be doing. This is a song about what my life is going to be like, and it's also an invitation to all of you to come and play with Paul and I. Jett, please, come up. There you go.
Well, the ushers?
Oh, okay, I'll stay up
well,
here.
Well, can you hear me? Will the ushers please come forward? And I felt that if I was going to be here with the Queen, I better put on a bonnet.
Lovely, lovely, my dear.
Isn't it interesting that now it seems that the men wear hats to church and the women have forgotten? Not all of us, anyway. Anyway, well...
it's a wiggly reality.
Right. So if the ushers would go ahead and collect...
God is the source of who I am. God is the dream of what I do. And if it's God I'm talking to, I'll give myself to be used by you. God is the source of who I am. God is the dream of what I do. And if it's God I'm talking to, God is the source of who I am. God is the dream of what I do. And if it's God I'm talking to, I'll give myself to be used by you. God is the source of who I am. God is the dream of what I do. Who I am. God is the dream of what I do. And if it's God I'm talking to, I'll give myself to be used by you. God is the source of who I am. God is the dream of what I do. And if it's God I'm talking to, I give myself to be used by you. I give myself to be used by you. Yeah!
Woohoo! Now, if you put your hand over your heart, this gift we give is God in action. I now send it forth to bless and to prosper. I know that everywhere it goes, it is creating a world living in love, one heart and one thought at a time. And so it is.
So it is.
Thank you. All right, announcement time. There's a thank you meme up there, right? So I would like to thank everyone that was involved in this amazing party and last night and this amazing party this morning. And I'd like to ask Sue to come up because Sue has some special thank yous to say. And you can just grab that mic right over there. This is the Mama Extravaganza party planner and producer.
Is it on? Okay, thank you. I am here by request of your new event coordinator. Just imagine that I have long blonde hair and that I'm about 30 years younger. I am the mama. Thank you for giving me that title. Anyway, this is what she wanted me to tell everybody, that it was so fantastic to have such a great event team again. And all of you that came and helped Everybody knew their job. It was just terrific. In fact, we were finished, I think, weren't we, just about an hour early so we could let the room rest? Yes? Lydia, 2 hours early? Okay. We bought those other 2 hours, but I feel better about it. Okay? So our wonderful event coordinator, Deborah Welch, who is going to be absolutely amazing, absolutely amazing. I will work for her anytime she wants me. She would like, for those that were there last night participating, will you please stand so we can acknowledge you?
Ah.
Yay! Oh, look, way back there. I can't see. Also, we still had more fans. These are a gift for you all to take, for us to remember. Give a wave to Karyl. And, now this is my other duty for our wonderful coordinator. And that is, if you would all stand, we have, which everybody has contributed to the gift. This is the gift. And this is from everybody, baby. Oh. You want me to tell you?
Oh.
It's 3,000 something.
My God, on top of that party.
Yeah.
Oh. Oh my gosh. Oh. This is going to go into setting up the guest room.
Oh, yay.
Okay?
Woo! So thank you all because you all contributed.
Oh.
It was a group effort for the party and a group effort for the gift. Okay, thank you.
You guys. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That is so unexpected. Oh my God. The party was so extravagant. And okay, I have to gather myself for the announcements. Okay, my final workshop is today. This was Elizabeth Hakim. Requested this workshop, and the title is exactly what she requested: how to download a talk from Spirit. And so we're doing it in the downstairs of the learning center. And so I think there are still some more spaces if you would like to come. Be sure to come. It's at 12:30. So I want you to take all this stuff over there. I don't think we're going to do it next week because next week would just not be appropriate for business as usual. So, and you know Paul. Paul doesn't want to put it back in the truck. No, absolutely not. We need a ride. Danny Halford needs a ride to the workshop. Anybody can pick up Danny and take him to the workshop? Raise your hand. Okay. Perfect. Okay. Okie dokie. Next, if you love food, do you eat?
Yes.
Okay. So sharing food with us is a way of loving one another. And, you know, really, that is all the masters say that. So if you would like to bring some food to share after service, I know that ongoingly your brothers and sisters will really, really appreciate that. The birthday a celebration this time of year is Cancer the Crab, us babies. And so if you are mostly a July person, I guess the end of June, and you would like to have a spiritual checkup, you come over to the practitioner table and fill out a form and then call one of those practitioners on the back, and that is your birthday present from our center. Woman Spirit Rising is September 12th to the 16th. And Lori, right over here, is the mama of Woman Spirit Rising. But there's information about that at the back table back there for the events. And then finally, my next trip, I'm going to keep on doing these, is Greece in 2019. And we all already have some people that are very excited about coming with us. So if you are interested, sign on the sign-up sheet. If you think, I've been waiting for this, Reverend Karyl and Greece together, oh my God, and you are definitely coming, indicate that as well. And I believe that is all of the announcements. And so, my blessing for you is that you live your life the best that you possibly can with every single high choice so that you may be a beacon of peace and love forevermore. And as always, Spirit guides your way. So if you would stand for the affirmation and final song. Bodhi, would you, Mary, you built out the affirmation because I can't see it. Oops.
Thank you.